Hello everyone, Assalamu alaikum. In this video, we are going to talk about the basic principles of management of maxillofacial trauma. Okay, so the human skeleton, it consists of 22 bones in the craniofacial region. If you look at the skull right here, the bony walls in this area are thin and they are connected by thicker, more robust portions. And these are called as buttresses. So what are buttresses? These are the thicker bones which connect the thinner bones together. So when panfacial fractures occurs, reducing and fixing these fractures at the buttresses is crucial to maintain the facial skeleton's architecture. There are two main types of buttresses, horizontal buttress and vertical buttress. Now it can be a short note question or a viva question. So listen carefully. The horizontal buttresses are the supraorbital rims, that is the frontal region, the infraorbital rims, the hard palate and the horizontal mandible. The vertical matrices are nasomaxillary. So this is the nasomaxillary buttress. Now if you look here, it starts from the canine to the piriform aperture to the frontal process. Okay. Then we have the zygomatic buttress, which is right here. It starts from the first molar region and goes till the zygomatic process. Then we have the pterygomaxillary buttress and we have the vertical mandible. So we have four horizontal buttresses and four vertical buttresses. Now there are two main ways to manage the panfacial fractures. We have the bottom up and inside out approach or top down and outside in approach. The first method involves fixing all the fractures starting from the mandible going upwards, while the second one uses the calvarium as a base and we go downward. But regardless of the theory, the principles of fracture repair include reduction, fixation, immobilization, and early return of function. So the first step in the management of maxillofacial trauma is fracture reduction. What do you mean by reduction? It means bringing back the fractured fragments together in position. It can be done through closed or open technique. What do you mean by closed technique and open technique? Closed technique means that you do not need to do surgery. So let us suppose we have a hand of a patient and the hand is now broken. We have two approaches to it. Either you can hold the hand from outside and give force to it so that it gets back to its normal position, or you can surgically open that area and bring back the bones together in position. So when you do it without surgery, it is known as closed technique. But when you do it after doing surgery, that means it's an open technique. Okay. So close reduction involves manipulating the fractured fragments to the previous position without direct visualization. You're not seeing the bones actually, right? That is why it is close reduction. Now external reduction devices like the Rove's disimpaction forceps, Hayton William forceps, Walsham forceps and Ash forceps can be used for this. Intraoral or extraoral traction may be necessary in cases where reduction is delayed or muscular forces prevent effective manipulation. So when the patient came back to you after a long time, okay, that is delayed cases, you can use intraoral or extraoral traction to bring back the fragments together because they get stuck into that position. Callus is formed, right? Now, as we discussed about the open reduction, it involves surgical intervention and allows for healing by primary intention. Then coming to second step, which is fixation. So in the first step, we reduced the fragment, that is we brought it back to the position. But since we have a fracture now, we need to fix those fragments together. So that fixing procedure is known as fixation. Okay, so the second step is fixation. So the fractured fragments are fixed by direct and indirect methods again here. So indirect fixation, that means close fixation, it can be done in following ways. Intermaxillary fixation or maxillomandibular fixation, that is IMF or MMF. Then we have craniomaxillary or craniomandibular suspension. Other methods are external fixation, bone clamps, Kirschner wires, halo frames, plaster of Paris head cap, box frame. In the direct fixation, that is open fixation, we have semi-rigid fixation and rigid fixation. Now, semi-rigid fixation means the fixation is not 100%, okay, it is semi-rigid, it is little movable. So it usually requires supportive MMF, that is you need to give IMF or MMF in support of the semi-rigid fixation. It includes transosseous wiring and non-compression mini plates. Now, rigid fixation without IMF is primarily achieved through bone plates. We are using bone plates here. There are basically three main systems of fixation of mandibular fractures. We have compression plates, lag screws, and reconstruction plates. Now, let's talk about indirect fixation, that is the closed fixation techniques, in detail. The first one is intermaxillary fixation or maxillomandibular fixation, also known as IMF or MMF, okay? It refers to immobilization of the maxilla and mandible in an occluded position using wires, arch bars, and splints. It is non-invasive treatment that is relatively simple, low cost, less time consuming. So these are the advantages. However, it has some disadvantages also, such as poor oral hygiene, because, you know, it's just like braces, orthodontic braces. So cleaning the area is very difficult. Loss of biting force and the potential of affecting the TMJ. Now coming to indications, intermaxillary fixation is indicated for minimally displaced fracture, unilateral condylar fractures, or when the patient cannot afford more sophisticated methods of treatment. Contraindications include severe asthma, respiratory and gastrointestinal disorders, psychiatric or neurological problems, mentally challenged patients, and seizures. So how do you do IMF? It can be achieved through various techniques. We have the direct dental wiring, such as the Gilmer wiring, Ridson wiring, and button wiring. It can be done by interdental eyelet wiring, that is the IV loop method, continuous or multiple loop wiring, cap splints, gunning splint, bonded modified orthodontic brackets, and intermaxillary fixation. So we have total of 8 methods of doing IMF, okay? So let us see the direct dental wiring, which is the first method of doing IMF. Here we can do wiring by 3 methods. By direct interdental wiring, that is the Gilmer wiring. Then we have the Ridson wiring and we have the button wiring. So let's learn about the Gilmer wiring. It is a simple, rapid method used to achieve immobilization, but it is a temporary method. It involves taking a pre-stretched 0.35 mm diameter soft stainless steel wire of 15 cm in length and twisting the middle portion of the wire around the tooth. So you took the wire, which is 15 cm in length, and then you twisted it around the tooth and we have the ends like this. So these are the free ends. Now you will twist the free ends together and you will form a plaited tail around 3 cm in length. This will be done along all the required teeth, and then intermaxillary fixation is achieved after reduction of the fracture and twisting the separated tails together in the upper and the lower jaw. So you do this in the upper jaw and you do this in the lower jaw, and then you twist the tails together of the upper and lower to achieve intermaxillary fixation or IMF. Coming to Ridson's wiring. Now Ridson wiring involves twisting 26 gauge 25 cm long wire around the necks of a second molar teeth on each side. Then both the ends are twisted together for the entire length. The twisted wires from both the ends will be brought together in the midline from the buccal side, and this will form our base wire. Next, we will take small wires and pass interdentally to secure each tooth to the base wire. So how to do that? So from the distal aspect, when you have to take the wire out, take it out below the base wire, okay? But on the mesial side, take the wire out above the base wire and then twist them together. After twisting it, tuck it into the interdental space. So this was about the Ridson's wiring. Coming to button wiring, here titanium button is used. It was given by Leonard in 1977. Okay, so titanium buttons was used here. Now coming to the second method of IMF, that is the interdental eyelet wiring or IV loop method. It involves taking a pre-stretched 0.35 mm stainless steel wire of 3 cm length and dividing it into several segments of 15 cm each. Okay, then you take a rod of 3 mm diameter and keep the middle of the wire on the rod and twist it. Okay, twist it around the shaft to make an eyelet. So here we have an eyelet. How many twists you give? 2.5 twists are sufficient, and the ends of the eyelet wire are cut off obliquely. Okay, you cut it off obliquely so you get the wire shape like this. It will serve two purposes. It will equalize the length and also it will produce a sharp point that will readily pass through the interdental space. Then the eyelets are drawn into the interdental space and twisted tight. So let's see the procedure. Here you can see both ends are passed through the interdental space. Then the ends are brought buccally from the mesial tooth and also from the distal tooth. Now this distal wire will be passed inside the eyelet and this wire will be here and they will be twisted together. Then the twisted ends will be cut and it will be tugged into the interdental space. So this way multiple eyelets are placed in the maxillary and mandibular teeth and these eyelets in turn are used for intermaxillary fixation. Now coming to continuous or multiple loop wiring.